the Sherlock Holmes Advent Calendar. An Odyssey Through Jerusalem by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Nora Godwin. Narrated by Peter Silverley. 23. The Path of Suffering. I raised my arm again with the pistol and pointed it at the alleged kidnapper. "Leave the jokes, Holmes," I said resolutely. "This is truly not the right moment." My friend shook his head. "I rarely joke," he noted, "and there is by no means a humorous comment on my part. I'm serious. Salah and Aaron are not prisoners but accomplices." Nevertheless, I kept my sights on the third man sitting at the table, while the two alleged hostages did not move. "Well, Holmes," I replied, "then please enlighten me." "Of course, my dear Watson," Holmes began, "I would like to draw your attention to the following circumstances which you may have missed so far, and underline the actual situation in this basement. As you can see, Salah and Aaron are in no way tied up or gagged. They are casually sitting on their chairs, and Mr. Habash does not threaten the two with a weapon, as a criminal kidnapper might do. He does not even keep a special distance from his victims. Last but not least, I would like to mention the wine bottle at the table. It bears a Hebrew label. Which Arab hostage-taker would be so accommodating as to serve his Jewish victim with kosher wine? No, Watson, our two acquaintances here are not victims. They are here voluntarily, and Mr. Habash, who owns this house, is also not a kidnapper. He is merely their host." The information provided by my friend was intelligible, but I still was not able to fully understand the situation. "What's going on here?" I asked. "What we see here," Holmes continued, "is the leading circle of the Zealot Popular Front in its interconfessional composition. A Muslim Palestinian from Jerusalem, a Jewish settler from Galilee, an Arab Christian from Bethlehem. They are united by resistance to Ottoman rule over the region. That is why they conspired and planned and carried out the known attacks together, with a few accomplices at their side. We probably burst into the middle of an important meeting." I turned in the direction of our local colleague, under whose roof we had lived in Jerusalem. "Salah," I told him, "tell me that none of this is true. You are not really the head of the underground organization that we had to investigate." "Sorry, Dr. Watson," Salah replied. "Mr. Holmes's assumptions and conclusions are correct." "But why?" I followed up a little desperately. "Why are you doing all this?" "I have already told you that," Salah claimed, "at least indirectly. I am concerned with the common and peaceful future in Palestine, for all people, and especially for my own children. Such a future is not possible under the rule of the Ottoman Sultan. I have therefore sought and found allies, even infiltrated the Ottoman authorities and developed strategies. And now we are on the verge of an uprising against the occupiers. You have to forgive that it was necessary to leave you both in the dark." Holmes disagreed. "There is no excuse for lying, threatening, and kidnapping us, although your motives may be explainable. However, it has been clear to me for some time that you have better contacts with the Zealots than an Ottoman official should have." "You've suspected Salah for a long time," I interjected. "That's right, my dear Watson," Holmes confirmed. "The perpetrators were often one step ahead of us because we had shared everything with Salah. Just think for a second, Watson. He was the only one who knew before we were abducted in the Jordan Valley that we were on our way to Mount Zion, where his accomplices lurked on us. It was to Salah, to whom I had announced that the Ottoman governor would come to visit the Temple Mount, and promptly the Zealots had prepared an attack. To me, that was the decisive test and the real purpose of this production. From that point on, I was finally certain that Salah was in league with the Zealots. And then, finally, his alleged kidnapping from his office, which took the biscuit. In the face of Ottoman military patrols on the streets, which kidnapper would still take the time to trash the premises without any benefit, if it was actually about taking the hostage out of the city unnoticed? And that would make no sense. The fact that Salah devastated his own office was not only overkill and too apparent, but also absurd and illogical." The Palestinian rose from his chair and applauded. "Bravo, Mr. Holmes," he said, by no means sarcastic. "You have observed and analysed all this well. I'm sorry I couldn't offer you a bigger challenge." "Don't worry," Holmes replied. "It was big enough." "Nevertheless, we have reached a dead end," Salah continued. "Although you may have convicted me and my two comrades, you will no longer be able to prevent the uprising."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.